Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. Excuse me. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today, 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 43, which was a good place for us to stop in our last lesson. You see, at the end of verse 42 was the end of the 18th setter. And for those of you who don't know, a setter, a Hebrew word, and its divisions of a book of the Bible prescribed reading at one sitting. So, in other words, this verse 42 was the last verse in the 18th setter, or division of the book. The 19th setter, of course, begins with verse 43 and ends with 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 14, therefore proving that the book should be treated, the original book was treated as one single book rather than two books. Now, and also we'll note that the end of this 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 53, kind of splits the history of Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, king of Israel, the 10 tribes, and also the history of Elijah the prophet. So with that introduction, let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up today, 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 43, and it reads, "And he," this referring to Jehoshaphat, who has just, we began his history in verse 42 with his beginning of his reign, "and he walked in all the ways of Asa, his father. He turned not aside from it, doing that which was right in the eyes of the Lord. Nevertheless, the high places were not taken away, for the people offered and burnt incense yet in the high places." Asa, the father of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, was also a very righteous king. Neither one of them ever fell into idolatry, worshiping the heathen gods. On the other side of the house, you have the house of Israel, the 10 northern tribes after the split, and they're worshiping anything and everything other than Yahweh. I'm talking Baal worship, Chemosh, related to the sun god, Molech, the god that the heathens would sacrifice their children to. So who do you think was going to be blessed, the nation of Judah or the nation of Israel? This, nevertheless, the high places were not taken away. These high places were to worship other gods, or they were utilized to worship Yahweh, howbeit it was still illegal worship. You were to worship Yahweh in Jerusalem. Not until the time of Josiah, who was prophesied some 360 years before his death, would these high places be completely taken away. Verse 44, "And Jehoshaphat made peace with the king of Israel." This means that he had friendly relations. And we'd already discussed in earlier chapters that Jehoshaphat's son married Athaliah, the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel, the king of the 10 northern tribes. And the repercussions of that unity, that marriage, we've still not seen the full fallout of that. You see, Joram will kill all of his brothers, making sure that there is no one else that can take the throne of Judah. But then Joram dies, and through a strange turn of events, Athaliah, the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel becomes the queen of Judah for some 6 years. Jerusalem would never be the same. Verse 45. Now the rest of the acts of Jehoshaphat and his might that he showed and how he warred, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? And yes, they are. You can read about them in 2 Chronicles chapter 18. Verse 46. And the remnant of the Sodomites, which remained in the days of his father Asa, he took out of the land. Asa not able to completely do away with the Sodomites, but Jehoshaphat was. The Sodomites, check it out in your Strong's Concordance, we're talking about male prostitutes. And you know what sodomy is. You know why God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. He's not going to put up with that. It's an abomination to him. On a spiritual level, the Sodomites, you could think of them as male and female, for that matter, religious prostitutes. 47. There was then no king in Edom. A deputy was king. And the stating that there was no king of the royal seed line of the Edomites, and a deputy was appointed to be king instead of the royal seed line, and that deputy king was appointed by the king of Judah, which controlled the area of Edom at the time. And the reason that was stated covered in the next verse, verse 48. Jehoshaphat made ships of Tarshish. These were ships able of making long voyages by sea, to go to Ophir for gold, long known to be the purest and the best gold. But they went not, for the ships were broken at Ezion-Geber. Now, Ahaziah, the king of the 10 northern tribes, Ahab's son, you see, he's being friendly with Jehoshaphat. He's saying, you know, hey, you guys are going down to Ophir to load up on that gold and precious woods, algum, as it's called in the book of Chronicles. And I'd like to sign up for that cruise. Let me send some of my guys with your guys and fetch some of that gold from Ophir. Now, Ezion-Geber is located on the southern portion of Edom, and that's the reason that it was talking about there was no king in Edom at the time, because Judah controlled Edom, which gave them access to Ezion-Geber. Ezion-Geber was located on the Gulf of Aqaba, and you see Jerusalem, the only other port that they had was Joppa, which was located on the Mediterranean Sea. But this port at Ezion-Geber gave them access to the Persian Gulf, as we refer to it today, and much more of the world. You see, if you go from the Mediterranean to the Persian Gulf, you had to go all the way around the Horn of Africa to do that. We learn in the Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, that these ships were smashed by a storm at Ezion-Geber. If one negative thing to be said about Jehoshaphat, it was the relationships that he had with Ahab and Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, the kings of Israel, the 10 tribes to the north. Why did a storm come up? Well, it states there in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 36 and 37, Eliezer, the prophet sent by God to tell Jehoshaphat, I don't want you going to Ophir with Ahaziah. That was the reason the storm smashed your ships. Verse 49. Then said Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, unto Jehoshaphat, let my servants go with thy servants in the ships. But Jehoshaphat would not. Now this is a second attempt by Ahaziah to sin. After the ships were smashed, they rebuilt the ships And Ahaziah wasn't giving up. He wanted some of the riches from Ophir. Jehoshaphat fortunately listened to the prophet of God and refused to let Ahaziah go. That was the reason the ships were broken up by the storm. Verse 50. And Jehoshaphat slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David, his father, in Jerusalem, in other words. And Jehoram, his son, reigned in his stead. Jehoram means, if you translate it, Yah has exalted. And Yah won't do as much exalting of Jehoram as Jehoram will himself. As I said, he will murder all of his brothers, the seed royal, to make sure, out of jealousy, that none of them could take the throne if something were to happen to him. He would be it, in other words. But then he ended up dying, and as I said, Athaliah, the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel, through a strange set of circumstances, became the queen of Judah. Things went downhill. Verse 51. Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel in Samaria, that's the capital, the 17th year of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and reigned 2 years over Israel. 2 years, not that long of a reign as kings go. And of course, we had that prophecy that the seed line of Ahab was going to be completely wiped out. Why? Because of what he and Jezebel did to Naboth when they stole Naboth's vineyard. All the males would eventually be wiped out. Verse 52, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the way of his father, this is Ahab, and in the way of his mother, that's Jezebel. They were Baal worshipers. In fact, his Jezebel's father was a Baal priest in Tyre, is where she was from, or Zidon, I should say. And in the way of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. Now, Jeroboam, the first man king of the 10 northern tribes after the split. He was infamous for making the two golden calves, of which he placed one in Dan and one in Bethel, and told the people, you don't need to go down to Jerusalem to worship Yahweh. Here you have these two golden calves. These two golden calves brought your ancestors out of bondage in Egypt. Worship them. 53. And he served Baal. This means that he not only served him, but he adored Baal and worshiped him and provoked to anger the Lord God of Israel according to all that his father had done. Things not going to go well when you're causing the Lord to abhor you. Now we come to the book of 2 Kings as it appears in the King James Version Bible. One thing to note, some of you have Bibles that state that the second book of Kings, commonly called the fourth book of Kings, as my Bible states. The reason for that is that in the Septuagint, which is a Greek translation of the Old Testament, 1 and 2 Samuel are referred to as 1 and 2 Kings, and therefore 1 and 2 Kings are referred to 3 and 4 Kings, respectively. Now in chapter 1, we come to, well, let's go ahead and read verse 1 and then we'll explain. Chapter 1, verse 1 of 2 Kings. Then Moab rebelled against Israel after the death of Ahab. Now, Moab had been under the subjection of Israel even before the split of the nation. Shortly after David's death during the reign of Solomon, Moab became subject to Israel, and it remained under the thumb, if you will, of the 10 northern tribes even after the split of the nation. And when Ahab, the king of Israel, died, Moab saw an opportunity. They thought, well, there's a weakness here. Let's take advantage of it, so we'll rebel against Ahaziah. In 2 Samuel chapter 8, verse 2, we learn that David partially conquered the Moabites, which partially fulfilled the book of Numbers, chapter 24, verse 17, when the Lord said, I will smite the corners of Moab, meaning from border to border, all of it, in other words. Verse 2, and Ahaziah, he's the king of Israel at this time, fell down through a lattice in his upper chamber that was in Samaria, and was sick, or he was injured. And he sent messengers and said unto them, go inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, whether I shall recover of this disease. Ekron being one of the five major cities of the Philistines. And as you can tell by the name, Beelzebub, the god, small g, was a god of the heathens. So you have the king of Israel sending people to inquire of Beelzebub, which means Lord of the flies. In Matthew chapter 24, excuse me, chapter 12, verse 24, where the name is the same, but the Greek translation or transliteration is B-E-E-L, and then the Zebub. And it states there that he's of the abominable idols and of idolatry, and it would be blasphemy to inquire of Beelzebub. God will consider it that way. Verse 3, but the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbit, arise, go up to meet the messengers of the king of Samaria, that's Ahaziah, and say unto them, is it not because, or was it because, there is not a God in Israel that you go to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? And it's dangerous to ignore Yahweh. The king of Israel sending to inquire of Beelzebub would be an abomination to our Heavenly Father. God says in Exodus chapter 34, verse 14, you'll have no other gods before me. My name is, the Lord your God is a jealous God. My name is jealous. And that's jealous with a capital J. Verse 4. And by the way, this angel of the Lord who directed Moses by speaking directly to him, now directing Elijah, by speaking directly to him as well. Verse 4. Now therefore, thus saith the Lord, that's Yahweh, thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but shalt surely die. And Elijah departed. Ahaziah didn't ask for the prophecy of the Lord concerning whether he was going to recover from his illness or not, but he's about to receive it. Verse 5, and when the messengers turned back unto him, Ahaziah in other words, he said unto them, why are you now turned back? You haven't been gone long enough to go to Ekron and inquire of Beelzebub and return. What are you doing back here in Samaria so quickly? Verse 6, and they said unto him, there came a man up to meet us, and said unto us, go turn again unto the king that sent you, and say unto him, thus saith the Lord, is it not because there is not a God in Israel that thou sendest to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? Question. Therefore thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but shalt surely die. See if Beelzebub can save you, Ahaziah. And you know, this kind of struck me funny that here we have messengers that the king, I'm talking the king of Israel, you don't get any higher on the food chain than the king. And he instructed these to go to Ekron and inquire of Beelzebub. But we're going to see that they didn't even know who this stranger was, Elijah referring to. And for them to take the word of a stranger, disregard the word of the king, which could cost them their head, seems a bit odd to me. I think they must have sensed something godly about Elijah. Verse 7, "And he," this is Ahaziah, "said unto them, What manner of man was he which came up to meet you and told you these words?" Ahaziah probably could have described Elijah himself. I think he suspicions that it was Elijah in the first place. You see, God sent Elijah to Ahaziah's father Ahab on many different occasions, trying to talk some sense into the people of Israel. I'm sure Ahaziah knew who was sending this message from the Lord. Verse 8, "And they answered him," this is the messengers, "He was an hairy man," this means that he was covered in a garment that was of animal's hair. You see, the prophets dressed in camel's hair or goat's hair, as it's written of John the Baptist in Matthew chapter 3, verse 4. John the Baptist also girt himself with a leather belt, and girt with a girdle of leather about his loins. And he said, "It is Elijah the Tishbite." He knew exactly who it was that was sending the word of God. And now I'm going to send Ahaz speaking to get Elijah and talk him into changing the Lord's prophecy. Verse 9, "Then the king sent unto him a captain of 50 with his 50. And he went up to him, and behold, he," this being Elijah, "sat on the top of an hill." I'm sure these 50 and their captain were thinking, you know, here we're being sent out to get this one little old man sitting on a hill wearing funny clothes. This is easy duty. We should be back in time for supper, no problem. "And he," this being the captain of the 50, "spake unto him, Thou man of God, the king hath said, Come down." And do you think Elijah really cared what the king commanded? Verse 10, "And Elijah answered and said to the captain of 50, If I be a man of God, then let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and thy 50. And there came down fire from heaven and consumed him and his 50. So much for easy duty. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 29, we learn that God is a consuming fire. Revelation chapter 11, verse 5, we learn of the two witnesses that if anyone shall hurt them, they'll have the power to have fire come out of their, proceed out of their mouth and devour their enemies. That's one of the reasons I think Elijah and Moses will be the two witnesses. Verse 11, "Again also he," this is Ahaziah, "sent unto him another captain of 50 with his 50. And he answered and said unto him, O man of God," this is the captain of 50 speaking, "thus hath the king said, Come down quickly." How would you like to have had that mission? You know, I think probably he didn't hear about what happened to the first captain and 50. I mean, there were no survivors to go back and witness to Ahaziah and those under him what happened to the first captain. Evidently, they knew they weren't successful. Had he known what had happened to the first 50, I think he might have at least said, please come down from there. Verse 12, "And Elijah answered and said unto them, If I be a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and thy 50. And the fire of God came down from heaven and consumed him and his 50. Well, so much for easy duty for the second group of 50. And, you know, I want you to learn from this. You know, it doesn't matter whether it's 50 or 50,000. You and our Heavenly Father are a majority. And the reason I say that is for the benefit of you elect. You know, 7,000, which is how many elect there are, and, you know, that will be how many ever God says is the right number. But 7,000 seems like quite a significant number of people. But believe me, when you're stacking them up against the inhabitants of the entire rest of the planet, it's going to seem like you're all alone. Remember, with your Heavenly Father on your side, you are in a majority. You are on the winning side. Verse 13, and he, this being Ahaziah, sent again a captain of the third 50 with his 50. Looks like Ahaziah would get the point and learn. And the third captain of 50 went up and came and fell on his knees. I think from this we definitely know that the third captain of 50 knew what had happened to the first two sets of 50s. But he fell on his knees before Elijah and besought him and said unto him, O man of God, I pray thee, let my life and the life of these 50 thy servants, notice he didn't say Ahaziah's servants, be precious in thy sight. And I think probably one of these 50, probably when they were approaching, Elijah kind of looked over to one of his comrades and said, do you smell something burning? Because, you know, this is in the same area where Elijah is. And, this kind of proves too, I think, that God has a sense of humor. Here we see these brave soldiers becoming a little less brave at the thought that they're going to be consumed by fire. The third captain of 50 continues, behold, there came fire down from heaven and burnt up the two captains of the former 50s with their 50s. Therefore, let my life now be precious in thy sight. And you know, this is the sign of a good leader too, because in verse 13, he not only asked for his own life, he asked for the life of his 50 men, the ones he was leading. This word precious means valuable. In other words, spare me and these 50 with me. Verse 15, and the angel of the Lord said unto Elijah, go down with him. Be not afraid of him. I think this him referring to Ahaziah, not the captain of 50. Elijah wasn't afraid of the captain of 50. And he arose and went down with him unto the king. God in control and reassuring Elijah. And you know, Ahaziah and those had good reason to fear Elijah and the Lord, not the other way around. Verse 16, and he, this is Elijah, said unto him, Ahaziah, thus saith the Lord, for as much as thou hast sent messengers to inquire of Baalzebub, the god of Ekron, the god of the heathen Philistines, is it not because, or was it because, there is no God in Israel to inquire of his word? Question. Therefore, thou shalt not come down off that bed on which thou art gone up, but shall surely die. Every male of Ahab's family soon to be exterminated. Verse 17. So he died according to the word of the Lord, which Elijah had spoken. Now, every prophecy, every word spoken by the Lord does come to pass, some more speedily than others, but they always come to pass. And Jehoram, which means Yah has exalted, reigned in his stead in the second year of Jehoram, the son of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, because he, this is Ahaziah, had no son. So Ahaziah had no son to assume the throne of the 10 tribes to the north. So another son of Ahab and Jezebel by the name of Jehoram became the king. Now, the higher critics jump all over this. You see, this verse is at odds with 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 51, 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 1, and 2 Kings chapter 8, verse 16, which we'll be getting to the latter two. We've already covered the former. But then the higher critics will say, yes, the word of God contradicts itself. The word of God never contradicts itself. And you see, the misunderstanding arises from the fact of in the second year of Jehoram, the son of Jehoshaphat. But you see, Jehoram actually took the throne 2 years before Jehoshaphat's death. Why? Because Jehoshaphat joined forces with Ahab when they went up to Ramoth Gilead, and obviously he wouldn't leave the country without a leader. So Jehoram, his son, became king at the time. So, and really to complicate things, we're going to have a king of Israel, the 10 northern tribes, by the name of Jehoram, and the king of Judah by the name of Jehoram at the same time. We'll be careful to keep them separated. Verse 18, now the rest of the acts of Ahaziah, which he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? And yes, they are. And again, you've got Baal worshipers, you've got the worshipers of the golden calves, you've got Chemosh and Molech worshipers. Things are not going to improve. God didn't give up on the 10 northern tribes. He continued to send prophet after prophet, but the people wouldn't listen. And it looks like they would have, you know, someone of them would have been smart enough to go and say, you know, look, when did all this trouble come upon us? Well, you know, I think it was when Jeroboam made those two golden calves, and things have just steadily gone downhill from there. Well, Elijah's mission on earth has basically been accomplished. When we come back in our next lecture, Elijah, one of only two people, let me add Moses in there, I think three people, but on one of only two recorded in the Bible that didn't die in the flesh. God took Enoch in the book of Genesis. He also takes Elijah in our next lesson. Don't miss it. We've got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free. The CD is free. No shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the United States, and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to be answered on the air, feel free to call that number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's Word in a positive format, throwing out negative about others, especially our brothers and sisters in Christ, serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. We'll let God's Word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing. If you're listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's not able to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? You don't need a telephone number. We can do away with that. You don't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I encourage you to talk to Him. I don't think you have a lot of competition these days. It seems like everyone is so busy, wrapped up and hurrying here, hurrying there, trying to make a living. But, you know, make time each day for your Heavenly Father. It's time well spent. It's time that's very rewarding, because if you make His day, which talking to Him does, blessings are always going to follow. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask You to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, addictions to drugs, illnesses, Father, financial problems. You know, Father, if it is Your will, a special blessing on each of these. We also remember our military troops who are in harm's way around the world. Father, watch over, guide, direct, touch, protect, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions and see what's on the mind of folks around the country. First up today, we have Gloria from California. And Gloria asks, why was John the Baptist baptizing before Jesus came on the scene? Was it for forgiveness of sin? I know that Jesus had to die on the cross for the forgiveness and to... what is that word? Snatch the keys of death. Snatch, I guess that is, the keys of death from the evil one. He destroyed he who has the power of death, which is the devil, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. And what had happened yet? And in Matthew chapter 3, verse 1, we learn that John was baptizing unto repentance. He was the forerunner of Isaiah and that we were told of that would come. And he told people, repent, make straight the way. The Lord is coming. Now, when Jesus came, he baptized, and John went on to say there in Matthew chapter 3, I baptize you into repentance, but there's one coming who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Rocky in Missouri, the years before Jesus came, how was time determined? Example, what does 500 BC mean? Okay, and some people don't know that BC means before Christ. So, in other words, in the years that we're talking about in the book of Kings, the years are gradually growing smaller and smaller as we come nearer to the birth date of Christ, because we're talking the years before Christ. And then when you come down to His birth, then we go into the time AD, which means Anno Domini in the Latin, which means the year of our Lord. Melvin from Georgia. Question, did Cain and his family survive the flood of Noah? Answer, Dennis said yes, talking about a previous program. This means that Noah's flood was not worldwide. It was a local flood. And then you go on to make some other points. But we know that the Kenites, which means descendants of Cain, survived the flood of Noah's time because they're listed in 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55, where they had already worked their way in as the scribes to the tribe of Judah. That was centuries and centuries after the flood of Noah's time. But you see, there's also one other alternative to explain how we had Kenites who survived the flood. You mentioned one, and that is that perhaps not the entire earth was flooded, and that is a possibility. What was God's plan for the flood? He wanted to destroy the descendants of the fallen angels, the Nephilim. And if they weren't worldwide, then he could accomplish his plan and by not flooding the whole earth. The second possibility that Kenites survived the flood of Noah's time is Noah was instructed to take two of every flesh on the ark. That would also include two of the various races of people, including Kenites. Taylor in Iowa, my first question, is it okay to pray to Jesus? I know that we're supposed to pray to the Father because the scriptures tell us so. Even Jesus tells us as well. But is it all right to pray to Christ also? Any thoughts, advice would be greatly appreciated. Well, you stated you knew the scripture. I'm sure you know Matthew chapter 6 when the disciples were asking Jesus, how do we pray? And he began by telling them, you pray, our Father who art in heaven. That's how you pray, according to Jesus Christ. You do not pray to Jesus Christ. You know, nothing wrong, though, with giving yourself credentials as a Christian by praying in Jesus' name. And when you pray, well, on the subject of prayer, always remember to pray God's will be done. That as you mature as a Christian should be more important than your own personal agenda. Your God's will is much more important than your own will. My second question is, where did Christ go during the time between his death on the cross and the resurrection? I have read a few different theories, one being that he descended into hell and proclaimed the gospel to those, say, this site, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 19, you're right on with that scripture. If you could direct me to places in the scriptures, that would be very helpful. And it was not to hell that he went to in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 19. It was heaven. But you should also know that there are two sides to paradise. One where the righteous are, one where the not so righteous are, such as the rich man of Luke chapter 16. But we learn in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 6 and 7, the flesh returns to the earth, the spirit returns to the Father. And where Christ went was to those who were on the unrighteous side of the gulf. And you're right, he preached the gospel to them, the gospel being the good news, and many did believe. You see, it wouldn't have been fair for God to let those who died before the crucifixion, in other words, they were judged under the dispensation of the law, that they would be judged with those who had the opportunity to live in the dispensation of grace. And that's the reason that Jesus went to even the playing field where all had the opportunity to believe on him. Pamela in Alabama, what is blaspheming against the Holy Spirit? Many different theories on what that is. Luke chapter 12, verse 10 and the following verses, we learned that blaspheming the Holy Spirit is for one of God's elect to refuse the Holy Spirit when they're delivered up before the Antichrist. Therefore, it's impossible that anyone has committed the unforgivable sin at this point in time. Charles in Texas, thank you and your staff for teaching the Word of God chapter by chapter. I've been going to this church that doesn't teach the end times, the three earth ages, what really happened in the garden, or anything on the deceit of the rapture. I quit going there to study only with Shepherd's Chapel, and I did pray on it for a while. but the pastor of that church has come to my home twice. First time I was ill, the second time I just put him off. Question, did I do wrong, or was this a test to defend God's word and I failed? Should I have tried to go toe to toe with this pastor? I'm afraid I might have stumbled, or should I have believed the Holy Spirit would speak through me? I pray for wisdom, knowledge, and discernment. God bless you, and God bless you as well. And nothing wrong with praying for wisdom, knowledge, and discernment. Excuse me, what is it? James chapter 1, verse 5 states that if any of you lack wisdom, excuse me, ask God. Now, you're a little confused. Should I have believed that the Holy Spirit would speak through me? You see, it's not time for the Holy Spirit to speak through any of God's children or his election. That time comes when they are delivered up to the synagogue of Satan, as it's written in Revelation chapter 2, 9 and 3, 9. And you know, you don't owe it to any pastor. It doesn't hurt to plant a seed. I have found that pastors are usually pretty firm in their beliefs, which is a good thing. But when they're teaching their people falsely and you have an opportunity to plant a seed to correct them, you certainly want to do that. But as far as an obligation to entertain them in your home, that's entirely up to you. Your home is your castle. Louise from Alabama, and thank you for your kind words. When we are in our spirit bodies, will we all be of one gender, since we all will be the bride of Christ? And spiritually speaking, yes. And I know that goes all over some of you hairy-legged boys out there, that you're going to be considered of the female gender in heaven. But actually, there is no gender in heaven as far as we have here on earth today. But Louise in Alabama, you're right. We will all be the bride of Christ. Pat, spiritually speaking, Pat in Georgia, is Bathsheba the same as the Queen of Sheba? And no, they're two different people entirely. Bathsheba had an adulterous affair with David, as it's written in 2 Samuel chapter 10 and 11. The Queen of Sheba, on the other hand, we learn about her in 1 Kings chapter 10, and that's during the reign of Solomon, and she's the one who came to visit Solomon to witness his wisdom and wealth. Bathsheba, 2 Samuel chapter 11, Sheba, the Queen of Sheba, 1 Kings chapter 10. Frank in Pennsylvania, where in the Word of God is the second influx of the giants? Well, actually, it's the second influx of the Nephilim, the fallen angels, which resulted in more giants. The flood of Noah, again, was God's plan to destroy the descendants of the Nephilim. There was a second influx of the fallen angels in Genesis chapter 12, where they're called Canaanites. That's Canaanites with a C. If you have a companion Bible, you have a very valuable appendix, number 25, which tells us about the first influx of the fallen angels, the second influx, which was began as early as Genesis chapter 12, and then more importantly, the one you really want to know about is the third influx of the fallen angels. They come at the same time that Satan is booted out of heaven, as is recorded in Revelation chapter 12, verse 6, and the following verses. Jackie from Utah, and thank you for your kind comments. My question is this: Jesus said he is coming back in a cloud of glory. Does this mean an actual rain cloud or something different? Please explain. Well, he descends from heaven, as we learn in Matthew chapter 20, verse 30, and also Luke chapter 21, verse 27. In Acts chapter 1, verses 11 and 12, tells us exactly where Jesus will return. It's the same point that he ascended, and that is, of course, is from the Mount of Olives. And, you know, cloud can be a term that means a multitude, such as a cloud of locusts, and I don't know if that's where you were coming from, but yeah, he's coming from heaven when those two witnesses are slain in the wide area, the pata, as it's in the Greek language of Revelation chapter 11. As they ascend, he descends. I say, come, Lord Jesus, come. He's the only one that can straighten this mess out. Bill in Indiana, my question is twofold concerning the rapture. First, from your reading and understanding of God's word concerning this, would you say that yes, the rapture of Christ's church is a distinct and separate event that will take place at some point prior to Christ's physical return to set up his kingdom and reign here on earth? Now, wait a minute. Why would the church be flying away into heaven if Christ is setting up his kingdom to reign here on earth? That makes no sense. Or no, it's not that, the rapture, but rather an event that takes place lastly, as it were. And then secondly, if the rapture is to be its own separate and distinct event, would you say it will happen before the tribulation, during the tribulation, or afterwards? So you're asking if the rapture is pre-tribulation or post-tribulation. I tell you that there is no rapture. The rapture is false teachings. You know, we learned that Satan will use the pulpits of the United States to spread and disseminate false doctrine. And rapture theory is setting people up to be deceived by the Antichrist. There is no rapture. Ephesians chapter 6, we're instructed to put on the gospel armor. And why do we put on the gospel armor? To stand against the fiery darts of Satan. Nobody's flying anywhere. And in fact, is when you have the armor on, it's pretty heavy. It makes it a little more difficult to fly. William in Kentucky, I try my best to follow the rule book, our holy Bible, and join the club. We all try our best. We all fall short, but we all try. However, I am a real country boy. You know that I was raised out of the smokehouse. Country ham is my prime rib. I am really having a hard time not eating pork. Wow. Being as most pigs today are raised on grain diet, can they be edible now? Please pray for me to overcome this health sin. And I'm glad, William, that you recognize that it is a sin against the flesh and a sin only. And I can understand and empathize. You know, I was raised not eating pork at all, ever. And if I eat pork now, it makes me sick. I mean, 2 or 3 hours after I've consumed, even if I don't recognize it as something pork, something that's fried in pork grease or has pork anything in it, 2 or 3 hours later, I know. And I order pizzas with hamburger on them. Sometimes when they're short on hamburger, they put sausage on those rascals. And I'll tell you, I pay for it. But And I started to say, I can empathize with you because the way you feel about ham being prime rib, kind of the way I feel about shrimp. When I go down to the Gulf Coast to get a little R&R, there's going to be some fried shrimp on Dennis Murray's plate. And am I proud of that? No, I'm not. But I'm letting you know that even I fall short in regards to following the health laws. And what's going to happen to you if you don't follow the health laws? You're going to be sick. The flesh. Lonnie in California. You, Dennis, you were talking about Adam and Eve. You said Eve came from Adam's rib. Arnold has said a hex curve. That's a big difference for a young listener. Please don't say I'm dumb because I'm trying real hard, but it's bothering me big time. Thank you, Dennis. Please forgive me if I sounded mean. Well, I didn't think you sounded mean, but what I said and what Pastor Arnold Murray said is the same thing. You're just misunderstanding it for some reason. I said that Eve came from one of Adam's ribs. And the rib, if you take that word back in your Strong's Concordance, you'll find that the word means a curve. And I believe that that rib was the helix curve of Adam's DNA, which is the same thing that you heard Pastor Arnold say. You see, DNA, as far as man's concerned, hasn't been around for very long, our understanding of DNA, but God has understood it for centuries and centuries. And I'm out of time. I do want you all to know that I love you a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying God's Word in depth. And you know what? When God looks down and he sees you with that letter that he wrote to you, the Bible open, and you're seeking knowledge from him and of him, by studying his word, it makes his day. And make a little time each day for him. Blessings always follow. Excuse me. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important this, though, you stay in his word every day, and your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus, Yeshua, he is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645. 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravett, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravett, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Peter. Here we have two books, 1st and 2nd Peter, that are absolutely fascinating. That great old fisherman. Telling us, leading us, directing us, guiding us, going into the depth, if you would, in that second book, into the three earth ages, giving the most accurate recorded account of the events that transpire and document that there are three earth ages, that there was one before this one, and one to come. Peter, the great fisherman, which in his gentleness and his kindness brings us two books, the books of Peter, that lead, guide, direct, even in your daily life, that teach and show you how to be happy, how to find that peace of mind, and to know yourself. The books of Peter, I know you're going to enjoy them.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Guess what? We're going to redo the rapture theory, that is to say, the soundtrack. They seem to wear out, and then it's good to talk about it again afresh and see if we can't dig a little deeper and understand with clarity what it is our Father would have us know. Is the rapture?